Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners is now in session. If you would please join us in the invocation. Dear God, we thank you for life and for this beautiful summer that we've had, which is coming to a close. Please give the board the strength and the wisdom to do what is best for Alamance County. Amen.
Amen.
Everybody stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge of Allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I want to welcome everybody here this evening. And before we get into the public comment session, I have a statement I'd like to make. In the past few months, I have been a little derelict in not following the rules and enforcing the rules. And it seems like somebody will always take advantage, but I wanted to let everybody speak and say what they had to speak. The rules are always listed out there on the page right across from where folks are to sign up to speak. And those rules will be enforced from now on, as long as I'm chairman, which is about 2 months. And those rules, I have added three others. With the board's permission, I will enforce those also. There will be no profanity, there will be no racial slurs, and there will be no personal attacks. Those are in addition to those that are published and were passed by this board. The first, Mr. Cox.
In the history of the rules in the United States of America, it depends on who you are, where you are, how you are. That's amazing. But hey, rules is rules. You know, I just found out last week, I didn't know this, I always believed through my teachings that the United States of America was one of the few places that had a constitution. But I started watching this thing, it's like a news report, and it's headlined Inside China. And they do like a news report of China. And the people over there in China seems like they're pretty much like the people here in the United States of America. They even got a constitution. The people's got rights. And then I got to thinking about it, and I said, well, you know, I wonder about them Russians. I wonder if them Russians has got any rights. And I go to the internet, and I'm doggone, the Russians has got rights too. There was a newspaper article, headlines front page today. A man said that his lawyer was not defending him in a murder case right here in Alamance County. Sent letters to the judge. Judge brought him over to the courtroom. He said, I'm not going to give you another lawyer. Judge says, well, hey, this ain't right. I got a constitutional right. Said, I'll not participate. Oh, yeah, you will, too. We have to drag you over here. And you'll be here. Constitution. What good is it if the people that are supposed to defend the Constitution don't defend it? I also see talk about this thing with the citizens' right to try people. I can get into that debate because I've seen them. I've seen both sides of it. I've seen juries that didn't know what they were doing. I've seen citizens lie. I've seen stuff happen in courtrooms that you just wonder about. I see things happening in government stuff. There was a show that come on that I watched last night. It's called American Generals. Watch that. It's amazing what Petraeus and other generals have said about starting with 9/11 to today. 9/11. A lot of people got hurt. My 9/11 is 9/17, 2 days from today. I know what them people up there feel like. Love y'all.
Thank you, Tony. Howard Beatty.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate the opportunity to speak. If you look on your agenda, on item 7-4, we were to bring up a resolution. Vice Chairman Lashley had put that on the agenda, but due to a number of miscommunications, the resolution that we'd like to present is not the resolution in the packet. So I've talked to Chairman Smith about that, and I guess we'll bring it up the next time. So I just want to say,
Howard, we'll put it on the next agenda.
Thank you, Mr.
That you presented to me.
Yes, thank you, sir. And the reason we were bringing that back in July of 2013, the General Assembly passed a bill, Senate Bill 399, which put a constitutional amendment, an amendment to our Declaration of Rights, on the ballot for November of this year. And I've become very disappointed in our representatives because they should have come back and had at least a press conference or a press release and informed the citizens that there's a serious question on the ballot for 2014. And I don't know that that was done. Matter of fact, I learned about this, I think, on someone's blog on the internet. So I'm thankful for the internet. But I would like to have been informed of this more officially, because this is a serious thing when the people are going to change their Declaration of Rights. And so I'm concerned about this, and I think we need to start a discussion about it. And that's why I raised my concerns to Commissioner Lashley, and that was the genesis of the resolution. I'm sorry we can't take it up tonight, but I appreciate talking next time about that, and so I just thank you very much.
Thank you, Howard.
Thank you, Harold. Commissioner's responses? Anybody have
any? I just have one. Tony, I don't normally respond to your comments, but
that.
But hang on. The United
States.
Hold it.
That's a personal attack.
You're out of order, sir.
Yes, sir. And that's a personal attack.
In any event, the North Carolina Constitution provides the North Carolina Court of Appeals and the North Carolina Supreme Court, Court of Appeals, and then Supreme Court. If, in fact, the defendant's rights were jeopardized, if they are compromised, he has the right to, in a murder trial, an appeal all the way to the North Carolina Supreme Court. So, not me to judge, or anybody else, whether his rights were or were not. He has the right to appeal, and therefore the Constitution does work. Thank you.
That's true, John.
Anybody else? All right. The agenda, approval of the agenda. Does anybody have anything they want to pull on the agenda? Any comments about it? Hearing none, is there a motion to approve the agenda?
Second.
Moved and seconded to pass the agenda as is, which will include the consent agenda. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All right. First item of business is recognition of Junior Police Academy program. Commissioner Paisley, John.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm not gonna worry about the microphone. If I need it, just hold your hand up and I'll go to the mic. I had the pleasure of attending a wonderful, wonderful banquet in which this young man and his mom were present. There were 29 cadets, if I got my numbers correct. This young man was the outstanding cadet out of the entire 29. They went through a rigorous program put on by the Burlington Police Department, Mr. Johnson, the Sheriff's Department, the Grand Police Department, and a number of other law enforcement agencies. These guys didn't fool around. I saw through that banquet what they had to do. I saw the films. I suspect Officer Laws is going to show you tonight. I just wanted to say thanks. I'm going to sit down because I'm not the guy here. This young man, his mom, and these guys are.
Commissioners, if I can have the liberty just to tell you a little bit about the Junior Police Academy program. First of all, I appreciate the invitation tonight to not only recognize our program, but also to recognize Cadet Sutherland here. And I'll tell you a little bit more about him. But the Junior Police Academy was formed back in 1996 through the Burlington Police Department. Graham Police Department got on board very soon after that, the very next year. And then the Sheriff's Office became involved with our program in 2004. And we've been going strong ever since the program started. The mission of our academy is to provide at-risk middle school students behavioral and social skills intended to help make them more productive citizens, not only in our schools, but also in our community in general. And so our academy's designed to instill in these cadets the skills necessary to improve attendance, improve their grades, reduce discipline problems at school, improve behavior at home, as well as reduce the negative kinds of contact that they may have with the criminal justice system. So the cadets are taught a variety of different social skills during the academy through classroom instruction, but also a lot of other physical activities, as was mentioned. There's a lot of sweat that goes into this academy by these young people. Our curriculum focuses on things like goal setting, respect, responsibility, building up their self-esteem. We do some blocks of instruction on conflict resolution and peer mediation, anger management, as well as violence and substance abuse and gang prevention. So those are some of the things that we cover. We bring guest speakers in throughout the academy each week to reinforce the topics that we're discussing during the academy. We try to instill in these cadets the value of community service. So we do a lot of work on community service projects throughout the academy to demonstrate teamwork, but also to sort of show them that these are positive alternative activities that they can get involved in to help keep them out of, you know, some of our gangs that we have in the area or drug activity and negative kinds of activities like that. So one of the projects that the cadets completed this year was a food drive for the Allied Churches food pantry here in Alamance County. They got to actually travel over there to the storage facility, take all the items that they collected, and kind of got a tour of that and that facility to see where the items actually go. And then they did another service project actually at the Allied Church's shelter, where they did some landscaping work and some cleanup around the shelter and helped in the pantry itself and whatnot. So, you know, these experiences like this really afford the cadets a chance to boost their self-esteem, as well as know that they're doing something to help other people in our community as well. So we had some fun activities with that they did, showing them that if they set goals and work through obstacles and problems and stay focused in order to achieve their goals, that there can be a lot of positive consequences in life. But this program doesn't just end after the month of July, because the program runs, the Summer Academy runs for 4 weeks in July. There's a follow-up mentoring program in place where staff members of the academy will actually mentor these cadets and graduates of the program over the course of the next school year. And so we not only touch base with them and kind of reinforce those skills that we taught during the summer program, but we also make contact with their parents, stay in touch with what's going on at school so we can kind of track their progress. So it's not just the summer program. We do have a follow-up mentoring program. So I do want to introduce Ray Sutherland, who is our top cadet of the 2014 Junior Police Academy. He's accompanied by his mother and also School Resource Officer Crystal Neal. Oh, she's in the back there, okay. And then Sheriff, representing the Sheriff's Office as well. If you all have questions for me or you'd like to speak to Ray here, we'll bring him up. And we just appreciate the opportunity to come and share what we do with the program each and every year. And then I also brought with us the photo plaque. I'd like to present that formally to you all in appreciation for your support over the last 10 years or so, ever since the Sheriff's Office joined us in our endeavors with these kids. And we appreciate that continued support. And I know Commissioner Pegsley got to attend the graduation. I think others of you have attended direct graduations in the past. And so we do appreciate all the support that we get from you all and from our Sheriff's Office here. It's a collaborative effort between the agencies that Commissioner Pegsley mentioned. So,
thank you for what you do.
Thank you.
We appreciate it.
Appreciate it very much.
Oh, by the way, the others are hanging, I think, in the sheriff's department. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
And this will be hung, Mr. Cadet, this will be hung in the sheriff's department with the other previous years. One last thing. I see at least two school board members here. Guys, you need to talk to Chad Laws and get a program, maybe not like that, but at least bring in the ministries, bring in anybody you can to help kids out in this fashion. This is way, way beyond what you do as board members, but I would beg you to do something similar to this with the school board. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Alamance County World Trade Center Memorial, Mr. Hager.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening. Good evening, commissioners. I'm here tonight to present to you a proposed design for the Alamance County World Trade Center Memorial. What we hope to do this evening is get you to take a look at this proposed design and then let us know that you feel it is appropriate to be the World Trade Center Memorial for the county. If you'll remember, back in 2013, Commissioner Sutton was able to secure a piece of the World Trade Center from the contractor D.H. Griffin. The piece that we secured, that Mr. Sutton secured, was from World Trade Center Tower Number 2, which is also the South Tower. Of course, was destroyed in the attack September 11, 2001. Our desire was to find a way to fittingly present this piece, this actual piece of the World Trade Center, to the public here in Alamance County. So we decided to enlist the help of Mr. Casey Lewis. Casey is a local artist, and he was he's here this evening. I'd like to ask him to please come up and maybe speak a little bit about how he's come up with the design. You'll be able to see it on the screen too, but if you come on up, Casey. Casey's a metal sculpturist, and his work is featured at hospitals and museums and parks, and we really appreciated his help. We tried to figure out a way to accurately depict the piece.
So. Casey, you wouldn't want to try to swim the ocean with that, would you?
That was part of lifeguard training, was holding something up like this. Have you held it?
I have. That weight is unbelievable. What would you say, 50 pounds?
I believe it's 20.
I can't remember for sure, but it's very dense.
Yes.
It's so heavy.
It's amazing.
Basically, I'll admit, it was a little daunting. When they first brought it over, and it took a little while to figure out what I thought was an appropriate way. And I talked to a lot of people. My next door neighbor's a fireman. Actually, the sheriff's department, police department, come by my shop often in the evening while I'm working, and I got the opportunity to talk to them. And the more I thought about it, there were, I think it was 2,752 people that died that day. And what kept coming back to my mind were the people who were running into the building to help other people at the risk of their own lives. And, you know, we hear a lot of negative media in regards to, you know, whether it be police officers or whatever it happens to be going on in the news, you know, that day, injustices, things like that. But nobody really takes into consideration that they're putting their lives on the line every day, and they never know what they're going to see that day. And that fact struck me, that these are the heroes of that day. And that's the positive message, that we still have people in our country, in our neighborhood, that are willing to rush into a burning building at the risk of their own lives. And the way it's presented, on the left is a 911 operator. They would be what I would consider first responders. The call goes into them. On this side of this particular picture is the police officer. And on the other side is an EMS worker. And on the back, on the right, or the bottom side, is a fireman. And so the idea was that the first responder started the process, and that's why that side is lifting up first. And the police officers and EMS workers who were organizing people as they went in and out of the building are the balancing point between the two. And in my mind, the firemen who were rushing into the burning building received sort of the brunt of what happened that day. And so the weight is on that side of the piece. The pedestal itself is going to be a representation of the World Trade Centers. I hope to include the signatures of the four volunteers that I had come over and allow me to take pictures of them so that I could get the details of what their uniforms were and things like that. I hope that this is pleasing to everyone, and this represents what everyone thinks of in terms of that day, and trying to put a positive spin on a horrible thing.
Thank you, Casey. A little more information about the piece. It is a permanent structure. It would be designed not to move around, so wherever it's placed, that would be its home. We would recommend that you consider, you don't have to decide placement this evening. The main thing we would like to know from the board this evening is the design acceptable? Once we start thinking about placement, we have some time for that. We would certainly recommend we find an indoor place to put it. We can add a plaque to it with a simple statement, something about, you know, the day of September 11th, 2001. We could do that too. The projected cost of the piece, I will talk a moment about the cost of the piece. We're projecting the cost to be $10,656. I will tell the board that I firmly believe that the community will pitch in to help make this possible. I've already had some discussions with some folks that would like to be a part of the production. So I certainly wouldn't want the board to be off-put in any way by the dollar amount. I think the significance of the piece, the fact that emergency responders play such a prominent role, that Casey is a local artist from Alamance County and has used local folks as models for the figures, will just help there be community acceptance of the piece and help us financially be able to do it too. So what we would like to know this evening is, does the board feel comfortable with this design, comfortable with us proceeding with attempts to do some fundraising to help make it possible? And then like to ask you to give some thought, if you feel comfortable with this design, we'd like for you to give some thoughts on possible placement. which I will just mention a few places that have been brought to our attention. You do not have to decide this evening. Possible locations include the county office building here in the lobby, the historic courthouse rotunda that has been mentioned, May Memorial Library, and the Children's Museum. Again, you do not have to decide tonight, but that gives you an idea of some of the places that have been mentioned. So if you have any questions for myself or for Casey, we'd be happy to try to answer them. But key point is, how does the board feel about the design?
Any comments?
Yeah, Tim, thank you. We appreciate what you did.
Well, I didn't. I got to be honest about it. I didn't really secure it. What happened, right here's a picture. You can't see it, but this is a picture of a piece in front of the fire department. And I went literally and locked on her door. And I said, where'd y'all get that? And I had seen a piece similar to that down at Fort Bragg, over to the left of the door there at Special Forces. They have a piece similar to this, but more scraggly. This is a solid piece. If you look at the design of the World Trade Center, the core beams were the solid that. These were more the outer beams, is my understanding. And that's why that is so solid. But this fireman told me, he grinned, he said, don't tell anybody I told you. And I didn't tell you the fire department, by the way. He said, but D.H. Griffith has got some of this stuff. And Griffith was one of the people contacted to clean up the mess in New York when it happened. So, you know, in all honesty, I knew they were taking care of a building for us. So I figured, well, if we're going to pay them that kind of money, maybe they'll give us a piece of the building. And y'all did it. Y'all the one that called them. But I was just the one to find out who had some. And frankly, even though it's a small piece, I would rather have a core piece than I would this great old big outer piece. And if you look at the design of the building, you'll see that the core piece, I think they had four going straight up the center, all the way to the top. Am I right on that? And then everything else around it was weaker, or not as strong, and then not as heavy. But y'all are the ones that called Griffith. I didn't call him, just to be honest about it.
Do we have a motion?
I would move that we adopt this design, the one that is the bottom with a pedestal, the first one that was shown.
All right.
And that we adopt a place to put it at a later meeting after we have a chance to go see the sites.
All right. Is there a second to John's motion? I'll second it. Any further discussion? If not, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, Brian.
Thank you, Stacy.
Appreciate it very much. And obviously, we like it.
Thank you.
Also appreciate the tilting and the explanation. And I assume that will go on a plaque somewhere explaining that information.
Yes, it may be that we can put something together that would hang nearby that would give a little bit of information about what the significance is for the different emergency service workers, why they're in the positions that they are. I think that'd help interpret the piece.
So all right. Do that. Very good. Thank you, Brian.
And I would suggest anyone that's here this evening get a chance, in case you're still here, you want to help to get an idea of the volume and what came down that day.
Let somebody hold it. Just pass that thing around.
If you'd like, yes. That's all right, Mr. Chairman.
Billy, you can probably appreciate that being in that building.
Don't anybody get attached to it. All right, Department Spotlight, GIS, on the screen.
It's a hard act to follow after that, but it talks about service. Looks like my PowerPoint's a little bit damaged.
It came up in the era, and I hit repair, and this is...
But I can still get through it, so. There was a seal there at one point. Alamance County's GIS department. People ask, you know, what is it? When people talk about GIS, Geographic Information Systems, a definition that I picked out was smart maps linking information from database to map. What the graphic that was there showed was, you know, it's not just a map, it's multiple layers. So you'll have a parcel layer, you'll have a floodplain layer, you'll have streets and roads and addresses and fire districts, and every year we add more layers. And what makes it so powerful is the ability to combine those layers together. So whenever a city annexes a new piece of property, we take that city layer and put it together with parcel layer, and then we can see the exact parcels that we have to make adjustments to for taxation purposes, for fire services. There's different people that get dispatched to those places, and those kinds of things. Every day it is a new challenge related to those kinds of layers. Combining all those layers together, again, makes it very powerful, and you can all of a sudden do some really good analysis that you couldn't do before. And every day we get asked in our department and other departments, can we do this? And we like to say that we can most of the time when we're asked. Our GIS, our mission, Alamance County GIS mission, is to provide user-friendly public access to GIS mapping data, provide and maintain the robust GIS mapping data sets and user applications for county and municipal staffs. Good customer service is our highest priority. Maintain all GIS data in compliance with state and federal standards and compatible with other GIS standards within the region, and always continually looking to improve and thriftily evolve with the advances in technology. Whom do we serve? We serve the Alamance County citizens above all. And the most important thing that we do every day is safety location services for those emergency personnel that you saw. So we do street naming and addressing for 911 dispatch and Dexter's group downstairs. And we do it for the county, and then we help in various regards all the municipalities around us and make sure it's in the system to dispatch correctly. We have all the fire districts, all the sheriff's districts, and all the EMS districts to make sure that runs as efficiently as possible. And every day we're improving the process. Almost equally as important as property rights mapping and support, parcel recordation and mapping. People buy a piece of land, they want to make sure it's been recorded correctly and mapped correctly, and the acreage is correct and they're taxed correctly, and we help with all of that. 95% of public services can be handled through our GIS website. If you've been to our GIS website, we have, whenever we get a new layer, we put it in there, and people use it all the time. It's one of the highest, we get hit at the county with the GIS website more than any other. People looking for floodplain, looking where they live, what schools they're going to, what fire district they're in. There are so many other ways they don't even know why how they use it, but they use it every day. And we try to make that user interface very easy so people can help themselves. In addition to that, we put all our data sets out there for free for the public at large to download and use themselves. That's very important for when people come. I've worked in GIS almost 20 years now, and when companies want to look to relocate to your location, they want that data ahead of time. They want to be able to look at that. If you don't have the data, they move on to the next county. So all this information is available through our FDP site as well. We also do customized maps for the public. A lot of them turn out to be commercial and large residential property maps, usually for marketing purposes. Again, a lot of flood mapping, kind of do some analysis on a piece of paper. And many people want topographical maps just for recreation or for marketing purposes. We do address confirmation for real estate. We have a lot of historical maps. And then people do historical research looking at our aerial photography going back through time. The tax shareholders and the public outside our county are demanding more bang for the buck. And they want interactive services, and they want it now. And they want more accountability. Percentage of time we spend, it's kind of small, but two big departments we help are the tax department and emergency services, not 911 and emergency services. The tax department, just about every person in the tax department now has access to GIS either through the web or through the software they purchase. The reval is coming up. We're developing more and more tools for them to do that accurately and compare it with their neighbors. I work with Jeremy all the time on this kind of stuff. The land use, looking to see if you qualify for acreage of your farms or trees or timber and that kind of stuff. The public can access through the website and figure out how much acreage they have or confirm it and compare and check what the county has behind them. so it enables the public to double-check to see if they qualify. In addressing services for 911, central communication, planning, inspection, environmental health, all need addressing service and location services at all times, every day. It's 35% of our time. Board of Election, they need to know where they live and what district they're in, and of course last year they changed all the districts, and so that was a big part of what we worked on last year. Like I said earlier, with the public, we have historical sites, preliminary floodplains, which haven't come into effect yet, but the public can see if maybe next year they're going to be in a floodplain or not, so we provide that service. Aerials back to 1974, and again, all the Board of Election district changes, these are just some recent things we worked on to show. For the Sheriff's Office, we do a lot of projects for them. In the DA's office, we do a lot of trial maps they use for all the trials. Cell phone towers, they get to, you know, with the, when there's a trial, if you commit a crime in Alamance County, you should turn off your cell phone because they can track you.
I remember that.
So, fire emergency management, we track the fire districts. Last winter, we had the ice storm, so we helped out with the tree pickup with the private roads and, you know, how much mileage we had to do to report to the state, so we were able to do that. A couple years ago, we had a tornado go through the north part of the county. We used GIS to kind of evaluate who got hit and what the path was. So we're
That's
always
amazing what you're going to see in
it. It is truly amazing, the different things you can use it for. Of course, we work with all the departments that come to us. We get once or twice a year, you know, attorney's office comes to our office or whatever, and we try to help out anybody we can, the school system, landfill, MIS, soil and water, parks and rec. We really work hard to work with the municipalities around here. Burlington is our equal partner. A couple years ago, they have accessed our data, and they are entering their data directly into our server so that we don't have error as they send it to us and re-repeat it. It also is more efficient. And then we help some of the smaller municipalities put all their information in for them. At the state and federal level, we're required to turn in lots of different layers, whether it's Board of Elections. We helped out with the 2010 census. The federal government said, if you don't help us, then you can't complain about it. So we definitely helped them out as best we could. So, why is GIS growing? Again, the public and businesses require instant access to data, county data. It improves efficiency. It allows proactive planning. You can do different scenarios with computer maps. You just hit the delete button. It doesn't take a few weeks to draw. Allows modeling, improved communications, faster response. And I like to think it reduced costs. GIS growth in Alamance County, just in the last 8 years, we've gone from 7 GIS users to 27. Gone from 1 GPS unit to 7. From less than 1,500 visits on the website to 15,000 visits per month. We have a teach a man to fish philosophy for our department. We don't keep asking for more staff. We try to train. If someone comes to us and want to use this technology, they usually buy the software, get some training in it, and we help them and support them any way they can. Environmental health is a really good example. They were hand-drawing septic systems on a piece of paper and scanning those in, and now they're GPSing it, which when they go out in the area again 5 years from now, all that information is there. It's not lost. And they see a definite benefit for that. All that information is going to be, once they get finished with the layer, be on our website. Again, we have better accuracy with the GPS. The technology right now is so good, you used to have to stay in one spot or have those big towers and like maybe wait 2 or 3 minutes to get that accuracy that you need. Now it just takes a few seconds and you get within a half a foot. So that really helps us out. And the interface is very much like a smartphone. Matter of fact, a few years, probably a smartphone will be as accurate as that. We gave GPS units to all the fire stations and they mapped all their hydrants and all their landing sites within a foot. That was a project we did last year. We are developing a reputation in Alamance County for quality at the local, state, and federal level. When we helped out with the census, a lot of counties helped out with the census a couple of years ago at the Property Association's Map Association Conference in RTP. The regional, Southeast Regional Census gentleman got up and spoke, and he said the best data he saw, Alamance County. We were surprised. We're just little old Alamance County with a few staff and doing the best we can with the money we got. So very proud of that, and you should be proud of that too. North Carolina Department of Insurance Office, State Fire Marshal's Office. We last year went through the whole process of creating maps and doing population estimates for them. They wished other counties were as helpful as we are with our maps and everything in digital representation. These are what they have said, not what I'm saying. And again, the quality and accuracy are not doing anything I'm doing. It's due to the people. And right now, in the last few years, we've really developed a culture of accountability and people that see the value in accurate data. So rather than someone at a computer say, I'm just going to fix my database or what I'm doing, I'm not going to worry about anybody else. If they see something wrong somewhere else, it's okay. Error exists in the world. They contact us and we fix it. So environmental health might see something that tax needs. We recently caught somebody that was off the grid that didn't record their building in the tax system using aerial photography. So we all help each other out. And that really grows because every time they go to their computer console, they don't have to worry about less and less error. So all these people, including the public, we get a lot of interaction with the public. You can't be afraid of error. Error happens. So when the public calls us, we fix it. We fix it ASAP. And so, it's too bad. I got pictures of all different people and didn't come over. But anyway, so again, to reiterate, it's due to our people. And everybody's bought into it, and it's been really, really a good thing. It keeps building on itself. People see the value of doing it really, really well, and it just keeps growing and growing. And everybody sees how we're all interrelated. Recently, you guys allowed us to hire interns for free, so they have experience. And we've taken advantage of that, and they've provided a lot of really good data, and we've given them experience. And we've had four, we're going to have a fifth one coming up. They've all gone from this internship and gotten a job within the field. I'm very proud of that, especially in this economy, this is the last 4 years. We've had an Elon graduate go up and they're recruiting support analysts. They analyze and map all the different people from all over the country come to their university. Another one's working as a software analyst. NC State's expanded their GIS program, master's program. They really see the value in it. We have a GIS coordinator come out, and now he's head of the GIS department in Danville from graduate school. We have Chapel Hill undergrad working for the South Carolina Department of Transportation. Some of the projects we've been working on last year, Shalford Park had a problem or a challenge. If you haven't been out to Shalford Park, it's a beautiful park, our park direct we've come up with. They have all these trails and they go back pretty far, and they was worried about if someone had a phone call or someone fell down or someone had a heart attack. So we looked at the project and we came up with a way of addressing and coming up with a way with, even if someone doesn't know what trail they're on, they can look up and see the color of the trail and the number and they know exactly where they are. And that's been pretty successful.
We was up in the Rocky Mountains last week.
Yeah.
And one of the guys on the trail, we was at the top of the mountain.
Right.
And he was talking to his friend, and he went to GIS, and
there he was.
He said, I can always come back to this point.
Of course, I always tell my scouts, compasses don't need batteries.
That's right.
If you run out of batteries, you're in trouble. So we've also helped with Healthy Alamance Elon Connectivity Study. We actually partnered with Elon University, and they helped finish a sidewalks layer. So they did some work, it helped us, and it helped them, which is a good project. Again, we're working on the revaluation tools for tax department. Dexter's 911 folks and our GS department work together so well that, you've already expanded into Mebane, over into Orange County, and Gibbsville into Guilford County for dispatching, because I think we do, again, reiterating quality work. And again, we talked about the fire departments with their fire insurance review. That was last year. And Board of Elections, they were using data from the federal government to do their auditing. And it creates a lot of error because the federal government's not nearly as accurate as we are. And so we've coordinated with them to use our data, and we've drastically reduced the amount of error to follow up on and check on. Those are just some of the examples of things that come across our desk every day. And again, it's about our people doing the work and believing in their work and the quality of the work. So there's a couple other things, but they're not there. But if you have any questions, glad to answer. Appreciate the opportunity to showcase the department. And again, we have all the technology that we need, and it's our people that really, they believe in what they're doing, and they see the value in it. So thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you. Brian?
Commissioners have a request this evening that you approve the expenditure of $29,000 from the Capitol Buildings Capital Reserve Fund. These monies will be used to make repairs to the door and security systems at the Alamance County Sheriff's Office and the old and the new jail. We have a number of door security mechanisms that are inoperative at this time. This does not have impact on inmate security. It's administrative areas, magistrates, property rooms, areas that need to be secure. But the system has failed, and we are using some backup systems now. We'll take this $29,000, if you approve it, to be spent from the Capitol Building Fund and add it to funding that has already been budgeted this year in the sheriff's budget. Their original plan was just to do an update, but before they could do the update, the system crashed. So we will take their funding, add it to the $29,000 I'm asking you for this evening. The total project cost will be $36,368. We will use the same vendor that currently is providing the security system to the doors over in the jail. So if we use them, that will keep our costs down rather than trying to get someone else from the outside to come in. So if you have any questions about this project, I'd be happy to try to answer them. But the request is to approve spending $29,000 from the capital fund.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any comment? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you,
Brian.
If you'd like, I can continue with the next two items, and I'd like to address those as one, if that's all right with you, Mr. Chairman.
Sure.
The county owns approximately 7.85 acres over on Turrentine and Stoke Streets in the city of Burlington. There are two major buildings on this lot. You can see it up on the screen there. It's Turrentine Street is the long section. Stokes is up at the top of the slide. And the two major buildings on this lot, the county owns both of these buildings. They are occupied by Ralph Scott Life Services and also by Lifespan. We have with us this evening Ms. Jennifer Helton, CEO of Ralph Scott Life Services. We also have executive leadership from Lifespan. Suzanne Bland and Lynn Crabtree have joined us this evening. Both of these buildings are in need of repairs. County owns the buildings. They're in need of significant repairs. Both Ralph Scott and Lifespan are interested in working with us to become owners of these buildings. That would be in the county's interest, we believe, as staff. Ownership of the buildings by Ralph Scott and Lifespan would put them in position to access funds through loans, grants, other mechanisms that nonprofits can. Both these organizations are nonprofits, and both have an interest in making repairs to the buildings that would be facilitated if they were owners. You have two resolutions this evening in your packet that we'd like for you to consider approving. These resolutions describe the property to be sold to both parties. We will do a formal survey, if the board approves these, to enter into the deed that will describe the properties. It will survey off the property and the building. We are proposing to keep a lot in between the two buildings under the ownership of Alamance County. It's about 1.5 acres of open space. We'd like to keep that for a little while and see if we determine any of the possible use we can make of it. If we cannot, we would recombine it with the two lots that we're proposing to sell to Ralph Scott and to Lifespan. The resolution that you have this evening lays out we could do a private negotiation sale with both of these entities, where if we can put a reverter clause in the deed, if Ralph Scott and Lifespan agreed to this, we put our vertical clause in the deed where the properties would come back to Alamance County in the event that Ralph Scott or Lifespan ever stopped being a nonprofit or stopped using them for the public good. In that event, the resolution that you have is allowing the county to sell the properties to both entities for $1 apiece. If the entities, as we start working with them, once they approve, you approve these resolutions, if they have issues with the reverter clause, we would attempt to use a negotiated offer and upset bid methods, much as we did with the OE property over on off of Webb Avenue. But if we go forward with these resolutions and you approve them, we will publish a notice of sale one time, 10 days before the transfer. And the resolution also gives county manager the authority to sign the deeds when we work out the details with the two groups. Work very closely with Mr. Albright. He has prepared these documents, and he's also worked with staff from the nonprofits. So this time, if you have any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer them. I'm sure Mr. Albright will be. And then staff from Ralph Scott and Lifespan are here too. So.
Any questions? Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
Mr. Albright, like the reverter clauses. That's good.
Budget amendments. New health director. Good evening.
So as you have in your packet, the health department was allocated $1,111 by the North Carolina Department of Public Health to reimburse the local agency, specifically Environmental Health, for the cost of food inspections completed during the summer as part of the summer food service program. And the summer food service program provides food service to needy children during the time when school was closed for the summer. We completed about 30 inspections of cafeterias, and those inspections were completed by the Environmental Health Department and the food and lodging specialist. These are entirely state funds. They do not require a match of any local funds.
Any questions? Motion?
So moved.
Second.
Yes.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Before you go, may I ask her a question, please?
Absolutely.
And that way she wanted to come back up. I heard about this a week or so ago, and then tonight I just input the word virus in U.S. because I wanted to ask you about it. But it just so happens today, U.S. News and World Report, 7 hours ago, according to this, headline says, kids severe respiratory virus confirmed in Northeast. And then it goes down, it says virus, this is CNN 6 days ago, and this is what where I first saw it, I think. Virus hitting U.S. may be, quote, tip of iceberg. And then the Atlanta Journal, September the 7th, a week ago, and I think this is where I'd seen it a week ago, respiratory virus affecting thousands across the United States. Are you familiar with this? Have you heard about this?
I think you're referring to enterovirus D68, is that correct? It's the recent respiratory virus that...
it's not Ebola.
No.
Yeah.
No. Thank God.
D68 had about a week ago...
Well, it may come. I'm sorry.
D68, about a week ago, there was a report nationally that 10 states were seeing an increase of cases. At that time, they did report that North Carolina was one of those states. Now, the Department of Public Health at the state level corrected that, and that there are no confirmed cases at this time in North Carolina, nor is the Division of Public Health actually working with the CDC on this, since we do not have confirmed cases at this time. But we are seeing increased cases around the country of D68, which is a respiratory illness. It's not a novel virus, which means that it's not new to us. It actually does occur around this time of the year. We don't usually see it in the same amount or the same magnitude that we're seeing it right now. But it actually, if memory serves me right, 1962 was the first time that we saw this in the U.S. So it's not new to us. It just seems that this year we're seeing a few more cases than usual.
What are the things behind it, Nora?
I have not seen any reasoning behind it at this time.
It's EV-368. Yeah.
I don't know that anyone knows particularly why they're seeing an uptick at this time.
But those are alarming numbers, no matter whether it's here, there, or
right.
Wherever.
And one thing that I'll add, like with most respiratory illnesses, folks with asthma or underlying respiratory illnesses already are more prone to more severe symptoms.
Can you forward whatever you get to the board?
Absolutely.
And management, no matter
when? Thank you for asking. Any other questions?
Thank you, Director. Tom, you have anything?
No, sir.
County manager's report? Assistant county manager?
Nothing.
Commissioner's comments. Any other comments? No comments? I have one.
I'd like to appreciate the Board of Education being here. Thank you.
Always welcome, Mr. Rose.
And Pam.
I'm on the back. I'm always on the back.
You hide behind Brian. I have a matter I'd like to bring up with the board's approval. I'd like to appoint a committee for our health insurance. I've talked to Tom about it briefly. Our health insurance contract runs out, I think, June 30. Isn't that correct, Tom?
It may be September, but yes, next summer.
Next year, yeah. And I would like to get some more feedback on this matter, and I'm going to ask Tom to head up a committee with Sherry and Susan from his department and go out and see what we need to do with the Obamacare. The health insurance has just changed so much and continues to be changing. So Tom, I talked to you about it. I think you know basically what I'm looking for. The board may have other things they would like to look at and see, but I just want to get a feeling at least, and we may want to go ahead and bid it out.
Mr. Chairman, if I could offer Rhonda Markle's name to that committee instead of Susan's. Sure. Rhonda's really more involved.
Yes,
in
she
the
is, certainly is.
Payroll insurance aspect in working with HR.
That'd be good. Board in agreement with that? Is it okay with everybody on the board?
Yeah, okay with me.
You think I'm gonna worry about it in 2 months?
All right, thank you.
Just don't drop me.
Motion to adjourn.
Simon.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m. and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the Commissioners' meetings may be made to the Commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.